You want to compare the two phasors, okay? So voltage or voltage phasor at a substation in Nasik has to be compared with a voltage phasor at Mumbai. Now, how do you go about this? RMS value is straightforward, because RMS value is just the peak 1 by root 2 of it. So therefore, there is no problem. You know, whatever be your t equal to 0 axis, Vm by root 2 at that you will calculate the RMS value at Nasik substation and the RMS value at Mumbai substation, you can directly compare them. But when it comes to comparison of angle, there is a problem. You don't have a common reference phasor with which you can compare the phasor at Nasik substation with the phasor at Mumbai substation. This has been a challenge, a roadblock, a bottleneck in our SCADA systems. So I'll take you back a bit further and say that, see, most of the control centers that we have today in the country and all over the world, you know, like for example, the Western Region Control Center is in Mumbai, Northern Region Control Center is in Delhi, Southern Region Control Center is in Bangalore, and Eastern Region Control Center is in Calcutta, and Northeast is in Shillong. So we have five regional control centers, and every state has its own control center. And this whole country is one connected AC grid. A whole of the country is one connected AC grid controlled through these five first state level control centers, then on the top of it, regional level control centers, and then finally a national load dispatch center or a national control center, which is located in Delhi. Now, these control centers are managed through what is known as a SCADA system or a SCADA backbone. SCADA stands for Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition System. And, actually, probably it should be the other way around. Data acquisition should be first and then the supervisory control should come later. But the way it's pronounced is SCADA. And from these SCADA systems, we pick up data and bring it to the energy control center, where a system operator does scheduling, two main operations the system operator does, scheduling and preventive control. So scheduling is like, for example, merit order dispatch of the generators, you know, to meet a certain amount of load, forecasting load for tomorrow, then creating a dispatch of generation for tomorrow. And then preventive control is, as you have contingencies, then you try to minimize the impact of contingencies, and then you do reactive power management, and you do many other things which can be done in the preventive control way. SCADA systems have their genesis somewhere way back in 1965, when actually in the famous Manhattan islands in the New York, there was a blackout, and when the investigation or postmortem analysis of it was done, it was said that, you know, there is not adequate technology being used in the grid for monitoring. And then subsequently, SCADA was brought in to improve the monitoring of the grid. And this led to development of state estimators that today we see in all over the world, you know, all energy control centers, state estimators, they came out of this pioneering work. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Beech mein loss hua tha kya? I got a message that there is a break in the connection.
Yes, sir. For some few seconds.
Okay. So I'll just go back a bit and then continue. Now we are connected again, na?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, theek hai. So I was talking of this Manhattan blackout, and what had happened in the Manhattan blackout, I mean, the postmortem analysis committee report said in 65 that, you know, monitoring systems are not up to mark and they have to be improved. So then consequently SCADA systems were deployed. So SCADA is actually an old technology, though you see today everywhere in the control centers. It came somewhere after 65, and around 68-69, you know, pioneering work of Professor Shwepe from MIT helped in developing the state estimators. And incidentally, Shwepe is also responsible for his pioneering work, which led to deregulation of power systems somewhere around 96. So Professor Shwepe from MIT contributed in two major things. One is development of energy management systems, or the state estimators, or the energy control centers, as you see in today's world. And second is bringing the another work is in the area of economics, where he introduced and developed the concept of deregulation somewhere around 96. So, but coming back to the state estimator story, so around 69, these state estimators were developed, and by early 80s, they matured. In fact, Professor Anjan Bose from University of Washington State University, I mean, he developed some of the state estimator implementations, which are now, I am told, available or repackaged, or, you know, in some form or other, and implemented all over most of the energy control centers that we see today, you know. And there are many vendors like ABB, Siemens, and so on, who give you this energy control center implementations. In all these energy control center implementations, the way things work is as follows. There is something called a remote terminal unit, or a RTU, which is in your substation. So for example, in Maharashtra, you will have at all your big 400 kV, 220 kV, 132 kV substations, for example, you would have these RTUs installed within the substation. These RTUs are measuring basically megawatts and MVAR and voltage magnitude. So they measure megawatt, MVAR, and voltage magnitude, or RMS value, and current RMS value. Nowhere they measure phase angle information. Okay. Now, you would say that to measure megawatt and MVAR, I need to do VI star, which is P plus JQ. And so how can I actually measure power, active power and reactive power without measuring a phasor? So yes, phasor is indeed measured. In that sense, it is measured. What happens is, if you look at today's technology of numerical relays or phasor measurement, what you actually have is a sampling. A to D conversion is done. You sample the signal, then you do a to D conversion, and then you get it into your microprocessor or DSP or microcontroller or whatever. There you do a discrete Fourier transform and extract the phasor, and then you do VI star, and you get P and JQ. In doing this, what you need to do is, you need to, suppose this is one signal, and let me change the color a bit. And let's say that this is another signal, so both sinusoids at same frequency. Then I need to sample them at same instance of time. And then apply a discrete Fourier transform, for example, 2 pi by n k plus k equal to 1, 0 to n minus 1 or whatever. Then apply a discrete Fourier transform to calculate the phasor. So now simultaneous sampling is the key to implementation or calculation of the phasor. Consistent phasors, that means voltages and currents with respect to the same reference phasor. And this is easily done within a substation, because you can have one substation clock which drives the sampling of all the current and voltage feeders, CTs and PTs that you are connecting to your instrumentation is CTs and PTs which you are connecting to your data acquisition system. So all of them can be simultaneously sampled using the substation clock itself, and therefore there is no problem in calculating phasors. Again, underquote, consistent phasors. That if you keep on changing every substation or reference, you can always, they are not consistent with each other. So you can, but easily you can calculate consistent phasors within a substation. And that is why also, for example, a distance relay will be, you have implementation of distance relays where you take the ratio of voltage phasor by current phasor and so on. So implementing consistent phasors with one common reference phasor for the substation was not a challenge. The challenge was to keep the reference phasor same across multiple substations far away. You know, that is where the challenge has remained. And so what was done is, since SCADA era, we could not do this. We could not have consistent phasors all along the grid, because this simultaneous sampling could not be implemented across the grid. So what we did instead is that we calculated PQ, because when you calculate PQ and you do VI star, you know, this, suppose the, there is a, this is like phi I. So this is like calculating phi Y minus of phi I. So whatever is the reference phasor information, that is cancelled out when you do this VI star. And P and the Q, the megawatts and the MVARs, this value information becomes independent of your reference phasor value. So what we did is, we took RMS values of voltages, currents, we took PQ values, and this is what remote terminal unit transferred or transmitted to the energy control center. And then there, a nonlinear state estimator, because you are getting product VI cos phi, VI sin phi. So these are nonlinear quantities. RMS value is also in that sense a nonlinear quantity. So you are getting nonlinear quantities. And then there, a state estimator would try to estimate again the substation bus voltages backwards from there. So our state is essentially, we have a grid. The grid is having substations which are connected. And if we know the bus voltages at the substation, we know everything about our grid, because then we can calculate current, we can calculate PQ and so on and so forth. And we need state estimation because our instrumentation will always have noise and bias errors. And so to filter them out, we take redundant measurements and then we do this state estimation. So all this was being done using RTUs. So actually, like, SCADA will go, you know, from energy control center, it will pull one by one each substation, pick up these values that I am talking of, and also the digital status of the circuit breakers, because you have to calculate, you need to know what your network is, you know, to do the state estimation or any network monitoring. So digital status is also picked up there. And then you bring it to the energy control center, then you do the state estimation, then you have a good state of the system. Otherwise, for example, in energy control centers, I have seen things like, for example, you know, on a transmission line, if just the data as it is displayed, you may see that in the line 230 megawatts is going in, and at the receiving end, you will see that 232 megawatts is, for example, coming out. So line cannot generate to this extra 2 megawatts, right? I mean, line is actually a noisy element, not noisy element, lossy element. And so this 230 megawatts should become maybe like 228 or 216, 225 or something like that. But instead, I see that at the receiving end, I am getting, sending 230 megawatts and getting 232 megawatts out. Now, this is happening because of the noise in the data. This is happening because of the systematic errors in the CTs and PTs. And unless a proper filtering is done, which is what exactly the state estimator does, it is a nonlinear least square solver over the grid with redundant measurements. operator will not get even picture of consistent with the laws of physics. So state estimator is a very important application for that. And this is how a legacy control center has been working for a long, long time. Now, is there any question from any participant at this point of time about what exists as of now most of the world?
Participants, you can unmute from your side and you can ask question.
Can I then continue?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. So this has been the this is how actually right now the most of our legacy energy control centers are working, and millions of dollars have been spent in setting up these systems. Now, in these systems, one major problem is that of time skew error. You are going from one substation to the next, and this takes at least a few seconds. And what happens is you pick one phaser here, then the next phaser few milliseconds or few seconds later, then few milliseconds or few seconds later from the other place. And then you bring all of them together at one place, and then you try to estimate the state of the system. So actually you are not getting anywhere a time snapshot of the system. What this usually the literature use the word like quasi stationary state of the system is being obtained here, but actually state of the system is not quasi stationary. For example, when the load is ramping up in the morning as people pick up activity, or late night when it drops off, or in the evening when it picks up, within half an hour thousands and thousands of megawatts will be added. So there is a very clear, strong trend going on there, and the system cannot be treated as quasi-stationary state. But yes, for merit order dispatch, for preventive control, for scheduling application, and for some good feel to the operator of what is happening in the grid, this did serve. This was the state of art in 70s and 80s. But something happened around mid 80s, you know, the GPS system, the geographical positioning system, was deployed for military applications. And in 80s, you know, in America, this was made available for civilian use also. So if you look at this GPS signal and military application of it, then essentially it's like, for example, if you want to intercept a ballistic missile, then you are trying to use this system for it. So you need to get location, then velocity, acceleration, trajectory, so that, you know, if a missile is coming towards US, you know, or any allied state, then an anti-ballistic missile can be launched and you can intercept it somewhere in the space correctly. So for this, both XYZ position and time location, all of and in, at what time where, all of this important is very critical. So therefore, a GPS also implements a very accurate timing signal based upon atomic clocks. And I don't know timing technology much, or I don't know anything about it to be precise. But what I can tell you is that it gives you one accurate pulse per second, with an accuracy of 1 microsecond. So your GPS signal gives you 1 PPS pulse every second with an accuracy of 1 microsecond. And if you look at this 1 microsecond in terms of angle, then it is 2 pi f into this error would be this delta t, which is 1 microsecond. So at 50 hertz, it is 2 pi into 50. Into 1 into 10 to the power minus 6 radians, or this will translate to only an error of about 0.018 degrees, which is a small error which is there. So the idea is that if I get this one pulse per second, imagine that there are 50 cosines happening between this 1 PPS, because our nominal frequency of the grid is 50 hertz. So imagine that 50 cosines are happening, and now so this 50 cosine signal, this imaginary 50 cosine signal, synced to the 1 PPS is treated as your reference phasor across all the substations. And from this 1 PPS signal, you drive your substation clock and then do the simultaneous sampling and then calculate the phasor from there. Then what happens is this phasor, all these phasors across the grid are synced to this same common virtual reference of cosine reference, which is coming from that 1 PPS signal. And so all the phasors across the grid becomes consistent. If you had, for example, you had used a network time protocol like what is there in internet available, then there you could have said, I could use the internet time protocol and the network time protocol, which has accuracy of the order of a few milliseconds instead of GPS. Will that be fine? So let's see. Suppose your time, if you think this 1 microsecond is like unnecessarily too accurate, think of it like suppose you had 5 millisecond time accuracy errors. Now 50 hertz means a time period is around 20 milliseconds, is exactly 20 milliseconds. So if your time accuracy error was 5 millisecond, that will translate to, in terms of angle, quarter of a cycle or 90 degree error. If you make it 1 millisecond, then it becomes 14 degrees error. A 14 degrees error, 1 millisecond, is too big. You cannot use phasor angle calculations like this. So therefore, actually, no other thing is really a good alternative for measurement of phasors, and it's only the GPS which gives you a proper accuracy. And you need this strong accuracy to calculate these phasors. Now they are using one common reference across the grid. Now once that is happening, what is the next thing that has to be done? They have to be brought to the energy control center. If you measure a very accurate phasor like this, but don't bring it to energy control center, then it is like that jungle mein mor nacha kisi ne na dekha. You did something very high quality instrumentation, everything, but you are not comparing it with anything, then what's the point? So these phasors are transferred to energy control center, and the device which calculates this synchro phasors, which has this GPS receiver and syncing and all that, that's called a phasor measurement unit. These phasors, because they are synchronized through GPS, they are called as synchro phasors, and they are transmitted along with circuit breaker information. Every phasor one cycle, that means you can transfer it at 50 hertz, or every phasor every two cycles means you will transfer them at a speed of 25 hertz, or every one phasor every 100 milliseconds, which one in five, which amounts to 10 hertz of transmission. So in India, typically we are transmitting these phasors at 25 hertz. So we are getting in 1 second 25 phasors coming into the energy control center, and just a little reconfiguration, and we can actually get 50 phasors every second coming into the energy control center from every substation which has having PMUs. Now compare this with SCADA, where we said that pooling time is of the order of tens of second or sometimes even a minute. So this is like looking at a Ferrari versus Maruti 800. You are entirely looking at two different type of technologies, two different type of cars, two different type of performance that you are going to get out of it. So they just can't be compared with each other. Second thing is that if I am getting so many phasors in the energy control center, I should also timestamp them, because unless I timestamp them, I won't know which phasor came from where, at what time. And I have already implemented GPS in my phasor measurement unit. So this timestamped, GPS timestamped synchro phasors which the PMU sends to the sends through fiber optic, and to transmit usually for this fiber optic is the preferred medium. So you send it through fiber optic to the energy control center. Then at energy control center, usually there is a box or a functionality or a computer, which is called as a phasor data concentrator. And that assimilates all these phasors coming from all the places and looking at the time stamp on those phasors. It says, okay, this is for this set, then the next set, then the next set, and so on. Now, I think here some more of the history has to be mentioned. Phasor measurement units were first developed by Professor Arun Phadke, who is the alumnus of IIT Kharagpur and a PhD from Illinois Institute of Technology, and a champion in numerical relaying. His book in numerical relaying is very famous. He has many patents in numerical relaying, and those patents have been implemented across a broad spectrum of relays that we use today. So he conceived of this somewhere in the mid-80s. He conceived of this idea of using GPS and calculating synchro phasors as an alternative to the legacy SCADA-based state estimation. So you will see his linear state estimator or kind of a paper somewhere in IEEE Transactions in Power Systems in '80s. And this idea was too far away in the future, you know, in fact, in '80s. So he actually did a reverse sabbatical at Virginia Tech, Blacksburg, USA. He was already a PhD, so he did a reverse sabbatical there, and he liked the university. So then he continued as a faculty member there. Earlier, he was working in the American Electric Power, and then he moved for sabbatical to a university and then continued his research there. And that's where he developed the phasor measurement unit technology. So in '80s, when he developed it, it was not something that was very popular or was not even much used at that point of time. But then in late '90s in North America, again, there were certain blackouts and grid incidences. And as a consequence of it, what happened? Postmortem analysis committee said that we are not using a very high-tech or a smart or a good monitoring systems. The monitoring systems are slow, out of date, taking few seconds. So we really cannot even do a properly. We cannot even develop what went wrong with the grid, because we don't know which circuit breaker operated first and which later, because the synchronization is not really up to that order. And if you look at the time frame in which a grid collapses, it is of the order of couple of seconds. And here your SCADA is going to take tens of seconds to compile the data. So how is it going to be a useful tool for monitoring a blackout? It is absolutely not going to be a good tool to monitor the blackout. So then, as a consequence of such reactions, the WAMS or the wide area measurement systems, as it is now called today, using phasor measurement units, started being deployed and started gaining more currency. And in 2000, its application really started picking up. Around 2013, Power Grid and JETCO, both of them took major initiatives to deploy phasor measurement units in India on a large scale. Prior to that, some pilot projects were already done, and Power Grid in fact had a roadmap committee set up for this, which itself was chaired by Professor Phadke, and Ken Martin and Professor S.C. Srivastava from IIT Kanpur, and some more European people also were there as a part of that committee. Professor Phadke was, of course, the chairperson. Ken Martin is the chairman of the IEEE synchro phasor standards, which are used to transmit these phasors. And then they came up with a set of analytics that should be implemented using PMUs. And it was suggested that 400 kV and above, all substations from both sides will be monitored by PMU. And this thing was christened as, URTDSM project, Unified Real-Time Dynamic Security Measurement Project. And when this so much of data is now coming into the energy control center, there was this question of what one should do with this data. The vendors were not having any ready-made analytics to consume this data. And the application basket of this data is going to be entirely different from what your SCADA is. The SCADA is like getting an X-ray scan of a system. Here you are getting an MRI scan of a system. You need to do something different with this data. And operator directly cannot do something, because if 50 phasors are coming every 1 second, there is no way a human can react to it. So you need analytics, and you need to analytics to improve your monitoring. You can use this analytics to improve your control, and you can use this analytics to improve your protection system. So this is called a WAMPAC basket, Wide Area Measurement, Protection and Control Applications basket. And a set of analytics was recommended. And then IIT Bombay was asked to agree or to develop the analytics for this. And this is how we at IIT Bombay came into this PMU, this thing. Because we were interacting with the committee also, and we were also before that also promoting at the various national forums that India should adopt PMU as the next level technology. And this is how we have come here. Now, are there any questions? Then I would like to take those questions at this point of time. Then afterwards, I'm going to take one by one the analytics that are being developed.
Hello.
Yeah.
Excuse me, sir. I'm Jaideep Shah. Sir, my question is this. In many diagrams, when we search wide area monitoring system, so when we collect data from PMU, it goes to PDC. But for many decision making, still in many cases, they are using SCADA. So as you mentioned that WAMPAC, so we need adaptive protection system. If we don't have adaptive protection system at substation, so still we are taking controlling action by means of SCADA. So yes, we are monitoring, taking samples, but decision making is there anything which is much faster than conventional SCADA at taking corrective decisions?
Yeah. So I think your question is about what are the analytics which should be derived from this synchrophasors, and I am going to discuss them as we go forward in those slide decks. So you will see those analytics.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Anyone else? Anyone else has a question? No, sure.
Hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Yeah, sir, with respect to the power system, you have already told many things, but my question is somewhat curious about that. Suppose in the case of microgrid, when we are synchronizing our main grid with the basic small generators, and during their starting, their frequency is very much pulsating. It has a lot of pulsations, but our grid has the constant frequency pulses. So in that case, this synchrophasors analysis has any utility on that side?
For synchronizing
from that point of view, any application?
No. For synchronizing microgrids with respect to the main grid, actually, you don't need a PMU for that. So I don't see. You see, if there is a grid blackout and you want to do a grid restoration, PMU would be handy tool, because as the different parts of the islands in the grid start coming up, you can compare the voltage phasors and the frequencies, and for synchronization frequency should be same, and the phase angle difference between the voltage phasors should be brought down to almost zero. So restoration after blackout, PMUs have an application. But normal synchronization with the grid, I don't think PMU is required.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, by analyzing all the control systems in the grids, there is a problem at that is April 9 at 9 p.m. at up to 9 minutes. So what was the problem that was detected by the that is the grid people? So they are telling that there is a lot of complication to control the grids. What were the complications to be monitored, sir?
Which is this 9 April 9 p.m. this lockdown stuff?
So the Modi has that is lightning a lamp, switch off all the powers.
Oh, that was because of that. There is a significant amount of load throw off which happens in the system when you switch off all the lights. Then lot of load is thrown off, and this can cause unless the generators are scheduled. You know, you bring down the schedule of the generators, ramp down the generation quickly. You will have problem of over frequency and you will have problem of over voltages. And this was the problem. This was the complication which was there in managing that thing, that you will have over voltages when the load goes off. And unless you back down generation significantly, generation has to be matched, right? I mean, the generation and the loads have to be consistent with each other. I mean, they have to be, other than losses, the generation has to be equal to load plus losses. Now, load drops down, generation has to drop down, and you have never seen such an event earlier. So you don't know how much load is going to drop down. You don't know how much even people are going to listen to this advice. So you have really, you are giving a shock to the system in terms of load throw off. And that can disturb or cause over frequency, or even it can cause under frequency. If you throw off too much of generation, it can even cause under frequency. So it will disturb frequency significantly, and it can disturb it can cause over voltages. And this was the worry for the grid operators at that point of time. But somehow managed it.
We are having a lot of control technologies, na, sir. And it was pre-detected, na, sir. We will be managing this time.
So, but who knows how much people, whether, see, for example, I didn't switch off my lights just because some prime minister somewhere said switch off the lights. I didn't switch off. I want my lights at 9 p.m. What has that got to do with coronavirus? So how do you know people will, how much load will go? That is an uncertain thing. There is no way. I mean, corona is still there, is it not? Even if you switched off the light, corona is still there. No, in fact, in much bigger way. So how did it help? So you don't know how people will react to such requests. And so you don't know what is the amount of load throw off which will happen. And without knowing, it's like saying that you are going to fall, and you are going to fall in a big way, but you don't know how, what the impact of that fall would be. Kitna bhi control system lagaoge, shock could be disastrous to the system.
Nahin, aapko pehle hi malum rahega na, sir, and the readings will be on your... That is monitor, na, sir. At what time the readings are, what times the readings are falling on.
But monitor pe to real time mein aayega na. Pehle kaise pata rahega?
Pehle wohi o'clock notice hai na, sir. So jo 9 April ko 9 o'clock hone wala hai, to 9 o'clock aap precautions lenge na.
अरे बाबा, प्रिकॉशन लिया इसलिए तो ग्रिड बच गया, लेकिन उसका मेरे दो क्वेश्चन है. उसका सिंक्रोफेजर मेजरमेंट टेक्नोलॉजी से क्या संबंध है, एक जो ये टॉपिक है, और दूसरा कौन गारंटी दे सकता है इतने बड़े शॉक के बाद कि सिस्टम अनस्टेबल ना हो जाए? कोई गारंटी दे सकता है क्या इस चीज का? जनरेटर में अगर थाउजेंड्स ऑफ मेगावाट्स रहता है, इतना सारा स्टीम लेट ऑफ करना कोई आसान काम है क्या? प्रेशर कुकर का विसल है क्या कि गैस कम कर दिया और स्टीम ऊपर कर दिया और ढक्कन उठा दिया? आप मैग्नीट्यूड ऑफ प्रॉब्लम तो समझ ही नहीं रहे हो कितना बड़ा उस समय सिस्टम ऑपरेटर के सामने आ गया था. That was a dangerous thing. सारे लोगों के नाइट शिफ्ट कोरोना में सबको एनर्जी कंट्रोल सेंटर में जाके 10-10 11-11 बजे तक बैठना पड़ा था. बट वॉज अ बिग प्रॉब्लम. यू हैव नो आइडिया. सिर्फ घर बैठे बैठे बोलना बहुत आसान रहता है कि कंट्रोल सिस्टम रहती है, ऑटोमेटेड कर देगी. अरे कंट्रोल सिस्टम क्या करेगी? थर्मल इनर्शिया कितना होता है जनरेटर का? कितनी स्टीम वहां पे? मोस्ट ऑफ अवर दिस थिंग इज हाइड्रो नहीं है अपना. मोस्ट ऑफ इट इज अवर थर्मल जनरेशन इज देयर. उसका बॉयलर्स कितने बड़े होते हैं, उसका स्टीम लेट ऑफ, टर्बाइन का इनर्शिया. कंट्रोल सिस्टम तो यार थोड़ा बहुत आगे पीछे मैनेज करता है. इतने बड़े शॉक्स को मैनेज करने के लिए कोई कंट्रोल सिस्टम नहीं है दुनिया में. प्रिवेंटिव कंट्रोल से ही उन्होंने उसको हैंडल किया, और कोई तरह से उसको हैंडल नहीं कर सकते थे. एंड टचवुड वो हैंडल हो गया. मतलब ऐसा है कि वो इतना सब करने के बाद नहीं भी हो सकता था, ये भी पॉसिबिलिटी है. और क्या क्या अफवाहें चल रही थी आपको पता है उस समय? फ्रिज खराब हो जाएगा, तो उन्होंने तो लाइट भी बंद करने बोला था. लोगों ने तो रेफ्रिजरेटर भी ऑफ कर दिए, टीवी भी ऑफ कर दिए. कुछ लोगों ने कुछ भी नहीं किया. अब ऐसे अनप्रेडिक्टेबल सिचुएशन था. बट एनीवे, कमिंग बैक टू इट, व्हाट इज योर क्वेश्चन विथ रिस्पेक्ट टू पीएमयूज? हेलो, ओके. सो आई थिंक आवर मैन इज नॉट रिस्पॉन्डिंग राइट नाउ, और आई एम नॉट बीइंग हर्ड. व्हाट इज इट
सर? प्लीज कंटिन्यू.
ओके, सो what I suggest is that we'll take now 5 minutes break, because it's almost 1 hour now over. So, and then I'll get into analytics.
Okay, sir.
Chal. I'm going to stay live only, huh? I'm just we'll have only a 5 minute break, huh? Not a very, very big. We are not going to have a big break.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I request participant, please be online.
मेरा म्यूट कहाँ से होगा यार?
हेलो
Sir, your voice is not audible. Voice is not audible, sir. No, sir. हेलो हाँ सर हेलो सुमन सर है ना सर माने सर
हाँ सर
सर
बोला सर
हाँ सरांचा अजून वॉइस ऑडिबल नाही होते सर जर लॉग आउट होऊन परत लॉग इन झाले ना तर सरांना परत और प्रेझेंटर मोड मध्ये शिफ्ट
हो हो सर चालेल चालेल ओके सर इकडे तर याच्यातच दिसते
हेलो
हाँ यस सर
यस सर
ओके
यस सर नाउ यू आर ऑडिबल सर
ओके नहीं मुझे अभी आई नीड दैट प्रेजेंटर मोड ना आई एम नॉट गेटिंग द प्रेजेंटर मोड
Sir, you are in a presenter mode. Kindly share the screen from the sharing tab.
So that tab is near to mic option.
वो three dots जो होता है ना?
Yes, three.
वहाँ पे आ नहीं रहा है. I don't know why.
नहीं नहीं sir. Near to mic option. माइक का जो आइकॉन है उसके साइड में अप एरो वाला जो साइन
है अभी आया चेंज हु कैन प्रेजेंट दिस विल अफेक्ट द चेंज कंटेंट
हां यस कर दो सर उसको यस कर दो
अभी मेरा स्क्रीन आ रहा है क्या
वेट सर
आईपैड का स्क्रीन दिख रहा है आपको
नहीं सर अभी नहीं दिख रहा है जैसे दिखेगा हम आपको इन्फॉर्म कर देंगे नहीं दिख रहा है सर अभी भी
प्रॉब्लम टर्न ऑफ इनकमिंग वीडियो अभी भी कुछ नहीं आ रहा चेंज
सर जस्ट टू द साइड ऑफ थ्री डॉटेड थ्री डॉट्स इन द साइड ऑफ थ्री डॉट्स देयर इज अप एरो
अरे नहीं मेरा आईपैड पे है मेरे आई एम यूजिंग आईपैड आई एम नॉट यूजिंग अ डेस्कटॉप
ओके ओके सर
मेरे यहां पे वो स्पीकर का
सर अब सर कैमरा ऑन हो गया
हां कैमरा तो ऑन हो गया
तो वही पे यस
ऑन होल्ड डायल पैड चेंज लेआउट इक्विपमेंट चेंज लेआउट करके देखो एक बार फिर से लॉग आउट करके लॉगिन करता हूं ठहरो
ओके सर,
मेक का प्रेजेंटर किसी और के लिए आ रहा है, मेरे इस पे क्यों नहीं? पुट मी, मेरे इस पे सिर्फ स्विच कैमरा और पुट ऑन होल्ड ही आ रहा है, दूसरों पे मैं क्लिक करता हूं तो मेक का प्रेजेंटर भी आ जाता है।
सर यू आर ऑलरेडी प्रेजेंटर, दैट्स व्हाई वो बोल रहा है कि आप औरों को भी प्रेजेंटर कर सकते हो, और लोगों को। तो आपके यहां पे स्क्रीन शेयरिंग का,
तो फिर मेरे इस पे स्क्रीन शेयर क्यों नहीं आ रहा है? एक मिनट, स्क्रीन यहाँ पे है क्या कुछ? अपना कौन सा है ये? टीम लिंक है ना?
हाँ, माइक्रोसॉफ्ट टीम।
टीम, अच्छा माइक्रोसॉफ्ट टीम है ना। स्टार्ट ब्रॉडकास्ट, एक मिनट देखता हूँ। आया?
यस।
आ गया, आया ना? यू आर शेयरिंग, अभी दिख रहा है?
यस सर, मींस आपका वाईफाई कनेक्टेड और हाँ सर, आईपैड की स्क्रीन आ गई सर। यस
आ गई ना। चलो ठीक है, गुड ओके राइट।
यस सर, पीपीटी
विल गो अहेड नाउ ना, स्टार्ट ना?
यस सर, यस सर, यू कैन स्टार्ट।
सो नाउ राइट, so now what UART DSM has done is that it has implemented, or rather it has, we have now connected PMUs at all 400 kV and above, that is 765 and 400 kV, all substations within the India have been connected with PMUs. So all the transmission lines, their voltages, currents, all the three phase currents, IA, IB, IC, VA, VB, VC, bus voltages, everything, you know, line CVTs, everything is being picked up, circuit breaker position for 400 kV and above, it is being picked up and transmitted to a PDC which is placed at the state load dispatch center. From there it goes to RLDC, which is the regional load dispatch center, and finally it goes to national load dispatch center, which is at Delhi. And I think more than 59 PDCs, 400 plus PMUs have been already implemented. And this JETCO, Gujarat Transmission Company, has its own separate initiative by which it has deployed PMU at 220 kV and above. And both of these utilities, you know, have taken their own initiatives in parallel, so around 2013. And at IIT Bombay, we have been involved in developing WAMPAC basket of analytics for both of them. But the Power Grid basket is like for all India basket. JETCO's work is mainly meant focused on for their own state transmission utility or JETCO. Now, I'll come to analytical basket a bit later on. But before that, I would like to share with you the experience that we have, which I have captured here, which is that when you are developing a new set of analytics, then the first thing is, of course, you have to dream and imagine. There is nothing that you have got in front of you. Next is you design. So in the design, the students come in a big way, you know, because these are R&D projects, PhD projects, master's projects, mainly PhD projects. And you realize them, at least in MATLAB and other prototyping things. And then, of course, once you have realized, prototype them in MATLAB or some such easy place where you can quickly prototype, then you go and develop a proper computational tool, maybe in C++ or so, which will be implemented in an energy control center environment. That's a product level development, not a prototype level development. And then you get feedback from your end users, and based upon that feedback, you test and adapt. And so that means redesigning, re-realizing, and this cycle you have to go through it. And as more and more feedback comes, especially graphical user interfaces and performance tuning of analytics is done, and so you evolve in terms of functionality, aesthetics, ease, and the joy that it gives to the end user of it. So this is a product development aspect of it, not just academic prototyping publishing, patenting, not that part of it, but actually product development, deployment, getting deeper understanding, and then redoing, rehashing, and re-improving it. Now, synchrophasor landscape, if you look at analytics landscape, I have classified it into three different things. One is, I call it as offline analytics. Then the other one, I call it as grid monitoring. And the third one as the grid control. So three different things, you know. Offline, basically the thing is here that whatever data comes to the PDC, it will anyway put it into a historian. You are not just going to throw that data away. So there are historians which are massive databases where you keep and archive and store this data. Using that data, you can, for example, do remote calibration of instrument transformers, or you can do estimation of transmission line parameters. So you can do model estimation kind of things. You could even do dynamical model estimation of generators and so on. So this is a historian-driven data or offline analytics. Grid monitoring is like what you had in the SCADA kind of thing, but at a slightly different level, at a much higher level. For example, as I said, that, you know, the SCADA has time skew error is so big that you cannot actually, for example, if there is a fault on a line and the fault is cleared by a primary protection system, subsequently you will see some oscillations going on in the system, which will gradually damp out if the system is stable. Now, these oscillations, also known as power swings, which are seen by distance relays, etc., you cannot bring it through SCADA to the energy control center because their frequency is like 0.5 to 2 hertz. And here you are taking tens of seconds to get data to the energy control center. So you are there talking of a frequency like 0.1 hertz. With 0.1 hertz, you cannot see an oscillation, or monitoring at 0.1 hertz, you cannot see oscillation which is happening at 1 hertz. So system operator is most of the time blind in real time or online to faults, oscillations that go on in the grid. But if you like, say, for example, that an electromechanical oscillation which takes place in a power grid is like 0.5 to 2 hertz kind of frequency, then the Nyquist sampling criteria says that to capture this, you should have a sampling frequency which is greater than 4 hertz. Now, synchrophasor analytics or minimum frequency that we use is 10 hertz. We are using 10, 25, 50. That's the three recommended frequencies for a 50 hertz system. So obviously, even if we are using 25, oscillation frequency is only up to 0.2 hertz or so. So all these you know, power swings, for example, they will be available to they will be available inside the energy control center. Of course, system operator cannot react to it that fast to it. You know, this is not a manual intervention kind of thing. But yes, even then the monitoring is available. And so here, for example, vulnerability analysis of distance relays are analytic, which consumes that. Then state estimation, for example, in the monitoring. So earlier we were doing also state estimation. Now also we have to do state estimation. The reason, again, as I said earlier, that noise and bias errors come from CTs and PTs, they are still there. So just because the timing errors have gone away does not mean that those errors have gone away. So you need to still do a state estimator, but now it is linear. Then you could do event detection, for example, line tripping or outage or fault oscillation. So event detection you can do with PMU data. This is part of monitoring data, oscillation mode identification. This was not possible with SCADA, voltage stability monitoring, and dynamic security assessment with voltage stability. So these are some of the analytics that you could easily do using PDC. Of course, dynamic security analysis was done during the done with SCADA also, technology also. But here you are having a more accurate real-time snapshot of the system, and that is what you are using it. Now for control application, so mostly this basket of analytics that I am showing you here are the ones that we have developed or are working on since 2013. There can be a bigger basket than this. Now, in the grid control, one of the analytics that we are working on is supervised zone 3 distance relay protection. So some participant did talk about adaptive protection. So this is the idea of adaptive protection here. But one thing which I want to specifically mention when discussing protection systems and PMU is that PMUs can be used to improve performance of backup protection systems, but PMUs cannot be used as an alternative for primary protection systems. So primary protection systems usually have to work very fast. You know, we say that without any intentional delay. So like, for example, 2 cycles, you want your relaying system to give your decision in 1 to 2 cycles. Another 2 cycles may be taken by circuit breaker, 2 to 3 cycles may be taken by circuit breaker to clear it. And the primary protection system may clear the fault in 4 to 5 cycles. Now, this 1 to 2 cycles, if you want to take the protection system to take the decision, PMUs are slower device. They will measure at best 1 phaser per cycle, then they will transfer it to the energy control center. Then there is a latency in transmission that may take 30 to 40 milliseconds. Then you would do something with it. Then you will go back and tell the relay, please do trip or don't trip or whatever. So it becomes very slow and unreliable. And if you have set it at 25 hertz or 10 hertz, then it becomes very, very slow for this. So primary protection system should not be primary protection system applications as it stands are not the appropriate basket of applications for PMUs. But I would also like to say that some PMU manufacturers like GE, for example, today are giving you phasers at twice the grid frequency also. So for example, for a 60 hertz system like what you have in North America, you can have sampling every 2 phasers every 1 cycle. And so it may happen in future that the VAMs may come to a level close to where instantaneous samples also are transmitted. It may happen. But right now, they are not the most appropriate things for primary protection. But zone 3, for example, supervised zone 3, we can do out of step OST application tripping, we can do adaptive islanding applications, we can do some of these applications. Now I will take up. This is just to say that product development that we are doing is using mainly C++-based with database in SQL, Qt for GUI, and many other technologies are used to develop a product. It's not just a MATLAB prototype or so. And around 10 PhD scholars and 2 postdocs have worked on it. And we have done the field testing at, this is one thing which I want to mention is that we have done the field testing of this analytics at National Transmission Asset Management Centers. And after that, most of these analytics are now deployed in RLDCs and SLDCs. So if you look at this particular slide, which I have here, this is the angle which is measured by a PMU. Now you can see this sawtooth kind of a waveform which is there, and this happens because, as I said, that the DFT will typically be tuned for sampling will typically be tuned for a 50 hertz signal. And now if, for example, the signal is at 49 hertz, you know, actually the grid frequency is, let's say, 49 hertz, then what it means is the DFT analysis tells you that these phasers will rotate at a speed of 1 hertz. In other words, the phasers, angles of the phasers or the phasers, they rotate with a frequency of delta F, which is 50 minus the actual frequency. And because of that, these angles here, you see that, you know, it comes down, then at pi radians 3.14, it resets because you are doing between minus pi to plus pi. Then again, it jumps and then this kind of a thing. But when you subtract this change, you will actually delta F into T change. When you subtract, then you will see the constant angle if it is not changing at that point of time. You will see over this 200 or 300 milliseconds, you will see this constant angle which is happening there. This data, when it comes to the energy control center, you know, this data has to be checked for many things. You know, for example, we look at plausibility check for input measurements, that is checks if VI and IR within acceptable limits. And we developed actually means with state estimation, we were having some issues during the field implementation. So we had to go back and we developed a tool called CODIT, which we reported in the National Power Systems last NPSC conference. We had a presentation on that also, that we had to develop a tool called CODIT, which will find out if there are problems with my measurements. Because if there are problems with my measurement, then obviously my analytics will not perform properly. And this can happen for many reasons. For example, tagging of ABC phasors may be incorrect. By mistake, you may have called B phase as C phase and C phase as A phase. Polarity could go under reversal. There could be many problems for that. And CODIT does a consistency check on this and eliminates it. And once you do that, then as this slide here shows, you know, the residual, for example, that you get in a state estimator implementation. So that residual really comes down, you know, this plot of maximum normalized residuals. As we remove the faulted data, and we get this. Now, what we do is we go and tell the utility that these are the measurements which we see as a problem. Then they go at the field, then they look at it. Sometimes there is a mapping issue, and then there are sometimes some other issues. Then they are sorted out, and then again, once they are sorted out, they are brought back into the system. So this is a system. This phase is there because you know, these systems are being deployed for the first time in the country. And whenever you do a first-time deployment, you will face such problems, you know. So, for example, here I am showing you that, for example, some places we are seeing 11.7% of negative sequence current. But 11.7% negative sequence current should not be there under normal conditions. So, it shows that there is some data issue which needs to be sorted out. So with such huge amount of data which is coming, in some sense, you can see that this is like a big data or a data science kind of project also, not just the plain simple transient stability, fault analysis, electrical engineering kind of thing. Here are also some signatures that we I'm showing you of erroneous data. For example, here you can see that suddenly there is a voltage jump here, and then again it resets. Or here is an intermittent outlier kind of a data in the frequency that you see. Suddenly, frequency seems to be reported at almost a zero value. Or there is a partial loss of data which has happened here. Or, for example, here the line power is close to zero, but it is megawatts wise, it is oscillating between plus and minus, but actually it should be very much of a zero megawatt kind of a thing. So data throws its, in real life, data throws its own challenges, and we have to handle those challenges properly. Now, one application which I'm going to next discuss is, which is entirely new, not usually done during the SCADA era, is the CTC, instrument and transformer calibration. So this particular slide is on CVT calibration, and this is how I have here this picture here. This is how your CVT works, right? I mean, you have a capacitance based potential divider and then a tuning reactor, because when you look at its equivalent, Thevenin's equivalent impedance, it is capacitive. So it has to be cancelled by a tuning reactor, which is inductive. and then a further potential transformer to step it down, and then it will come to this 110 kV three phase or so, and then you will connect a burden with it. So this kind of a thing is an alternative to a PT, otherwise where you would have put a huge electromagnetic transformer itself, but then that would have become very bulky. This is much, much cheaper, less costly. But the problem here with CVT is, due to aging of dielectrics, shorting of the capacitor elements, and sometimes shorting of tuning reactor turns, this ratio will be altered. C1 by C2 ratio will be altered. And because of this alteration in this ratio, you will get what is known as a bias error or a systematic error in your CVT measurement. So for example, you may read 1% higher or 2% higher, or you may read, you will see an angle shift of say 45 minutes or so. And this has consequences on what you infer. For example, for a 400 kV, 40 kilometer line with 1% error in magnitude, it implies about 50 MVAR reactive power flow error. Or if you have, for example, 0.5 degree error in angle measurement, this would imply about 100 megawatt error in the active power flow. Approximately, do you recall this? P1 is equal to V1 V2 by X sine delta. And if you do the sensitivity analysis, then this is V2 by X cos of delta naught times of delta delta. And this stiffness constant into 0.5 degrees translates to around this 100 megawatts. That's what I'm trying to point out to you here. So these are quite big errors. I mean, see, earlier you may say in SCADA time bhi the, abhi kya problem hai, why are suddenly we becoming so much worried about it? The reason is, SCADA time mein jo time skew error tha, in the time skew error that was present during the SCADA time, was so big that these calib errors were hidden. But now that we have time synchronized measurements, highly fine-tuned time synchronized measurements, in the instrumentation chain prior to that, these errors are impacting the quality of your results, and so therefore we need to calibrate the CTs and the CVTs. For example, here I have a set of voltages that you are in a substation, and you can see that this is a substation in which say 8 to 10 transmission lines are there, and CVT or a line CVT is connected to each one of them, and then there is also a voltage CVT, bus CVT, which is there. And in A phase, you can see that the voltages are going from 1 to 1.04 per unit. B phase, you are seeing that it is going from 1.02 to 1.06 per unit. One per unit is 400 kV. And C phase, it is going from 1.02 to about 1.04 per unit. So you can see that A phase, and they are supposed to be, since all the circuit breakers in the substation are same, they are all supposed to be only one bus voltage, but you are now seeing a significant amount of difference here. So this is what I am trying to say, that this tells you that you actually need a calibration data to be done. And if I look at the angle, for example, you can see that same bus angle by 10 different CVTs. For A phase, the bus angle measurement is varying from 1 degree to minus 0.5 degree. And usually, for example, here in the A phase, you would suspect that 1 degree because it is an outlier. And so this is also bringing out that problem of that unless you calibrate it well, your decision making would be erroneous. So the URT DSM project had a CT-CVT calibration module, and new algorithms were developed for them at the lab for it. And now here I have shown you for different dates, you know, the calibrated values of different CVTs and the ratio correction factors, and you can see that they should not change with days, and that's how they are not changing here also with days. So this is the kind of activity that we need to do. Now, I take the next application that I am taking up is that of line power parameter estimation. See, line parameters means we talk of positive sequence parameters, negative sequence parameters, and zero sequence. These are the three parameters that typically we talk of transmission line. Now, positive sequence and negative sequence parameters are identical. Usually, they are known very accurately also, because they basically depend upon GMD, GMR, and the logarithm of, or the ratio of the logarithmic ratio of the logarithm of the ratio of GMD and GMR. And there is no ground return or does not play any role into it, because positive or negative sequence currents are balanced. So the sum is in the three phases is zero, and so nothing will flow back through the ground. The logarithm also gives you a very good damping. So if you, for example, have read a book like Elgard for power system analysis, you would have seen that 100% error in the geometrical mean distance will also only translate to about 11% error in the series reactance value. So unless you have really made a messed up with your line length, the positive sequence value should come out to be accurate. This itself can be used to check whether, not only to check your positive sequence values of transmission lines, but this can itself, positive sequence measurement can be used to check whether your CT CVTs are having any bias errors or not. And so we developed some tests for that to see how, what is the CVT, CT CVT accuracies or instrument transformer accuracy, known as zero conductance shunt conductance test. And it gives a decibel score. And the score is like this, that if it's just plain noise, but there is no systematic error, you will get score somewhere around after minus 60 dB. Between minus 60 dB to 40 dB, you have systematic errors and gross errors. And above that, you have only gross errors. So when we implemented it and saw then on some data set here, for one line, for example, you see that there is a systematic error, while for other line, there is not. And the idea here is that I1 plus I2 divided by V1 plus V2 is equal to the JB by 2. Ideally, it should be the JB by 2 or the shunt capacitance of the line. So the real part of it should come out to be zero. But if there are CT CVT errors, instrumentation transformer errors, then the real part of the shunt susceptance or the shunt susceptance would not come zero for a pi equivalent of line, indicating the problem. Another test that we developed is called a midpoint voltage test, for example, where we take the two PMUs at the two ends and calculate the midpoint and see if there is a difference in the voltage which is coming there. And for example, here you can see that phase A and phase C, there are significant voltage difference of about 1% or so for a 400 kV system at the midpoint calculated from the two ends. And it indicates that there is a error happening in it. So what we did is we said, okay, let's now see how this impacts the transmission line parameters. And so the transmission line parameters are calculated using this following equation here. You can easily derive it, VS square minus VR square divided by IS VR minus IR VS, and JBS by 2 is IS plus IRB divided by VS plus VR for a pi equivalent of a line. And now this is over 1 week PMU data after calibration. Treating the reference or the design values as the datum values or the base values. If you look at R, X, and B by 2, the base values are here, design values 3.84 ohms, 41 ohms, 2.51 into 10 to the power minus 4 mho. So X by R ratio is around 10 to 11 of this line. You can see that quite consistently nice accurate values are obtained for the positive sequence. But now let me show you a 765 kV 230 kilometer line example here. If I had not done this calibration, line resistance before calibration, if I calculate, you will see that the per unit resistance, that means with respect to the design value, I am getting resistances which are 8 to 9 times the design values. And if I look at line reactance calculation, that is like 1.15 per unit, 15% more. Here, 800% more. So line resistance is very sensitive to, if your CT CVTs are not calibrated, it will show up in very inappropriate line resistance values. Similarly, but after calibration, you can see that it has come to about 1.2 times the design values, and the line reactance value is almost 1.025 is where it is centered. So just looking at this expression, you know, you can actually figure out, and implementing it with PMU data, you can figure out a lot whether your CT CVTs require calibration or not. So we did a lot of test developments like this MPV, ZSC, line parameter estimation. They are all deployed now in the field, and from there we find out whether the this thing is not only whether the lines are calibrated or reasonably or not. If they are, we will actually be able to find out positive sequence, negative sequence, and zero sequence values. Zero sequence values can differ from the design values. I just want to mention it here, because there is a ground return which happens, and the ground return, we actually don't know the ground resistances over long distances. So we make some approximations in the Carson's coefficient and use that. And therefore, 8 to 10% changes can happen. But it is difficult to measure zero sequence values because from PMU data, because most of the time, the system is more or less balanced. So the zero sequence excitation is not there in the system. And without enough excitation, zero sequence excitation, measurement will be a challenge. Now I am going to take one more application of linear state estimator. This is also, this also has been already deployed at all RLDCs. There are the measurements block which you see here is coming from the PMUs. Topology is also measured by PMUs. Parameters, line parameters, this is static. We already know them, static database. Then here in the state estimator, this is like I equal to YV, VR, and V equal to some identity times again V plus the error, the noise. So this is the PMU data. This I's and this is the measurement data, I and V, which is coming here. Admittances of the line you already know. So this is the line data. And now this is a overdetermined linear least squares problem. And you can implement a simple linear state estimator, not you don't need a nonlinear system. So the idea is, like, for example, in load flow equation, load flow analysis, you first talk of a linear model like I equal to Y bus times of V, is it not? And then afterwards, when dealing with PQ, your model becomes nonlinear, so you talk of Newton-Raphson method. So similarly here, now that we are directly talking in terms of I and V, our state estimator itself is turning out to be a simple linear least squares problem. But with SCADA, we needed, like Newton-Raphson, we needed here a nonlinear least squares. So now, even though the data is coming every 40 milliseconds, because the nonlinear iterations are avoided, nonlinearity means iterations, but since those iterations are avoided, and we exploit sparsity in our factorization schemes, we are actually able to complete the state estimation every 40 milliseconds, which is a good feat, I would say. Only once and while the topology changes, we have to recalibrate it. These are some of the views, you know, and this view I'm emphasizing, showing it to you for two reasons. PMU data is a time series data. SCADA data was not a time series data, but PMU data is a time series data, as you see here. And you can visualize it through clock diagrams, and you can visualize it as time series. Again, you can have trending plots for them as you are, and all these screens have been developed in the lab, incidentally. Everything here, from the heat map that you see to the substation SLD, which is there, this is all done at IIT Bombay. Now I'll take one more application, online vulnerability distance resilient, then take questions and close. So as I said, because I wanted to take one protection application, one monitoring application. So if you look at basically normal operation, the distance relay is just looking at positive sequence values of line current, bus voltage to line current. On line voltage to line, this is what you are looking. And as I said earlier, that if there is a fault and fault is cleared, then you would see a swing in the calculated impedance. This is the swing which I have shown here. And if this swing comes close to the zone 3, then a line may trip. And this is an unwarranted or a mal operation of a line. This can also happen because of load encroachment. In fact, the 2012-13 blackout was a consequence of it got triggered by the incorrect operation of the distance relay on a Gwalior Bina line due to load encroachment. And if that had not tripped, the complete blackout would not have happened, you know. So that was the last straw which broke the camel's neck. So with PMU, you can actually monitor this. And the idea is that you can therefore identify if there are any relays which are vulnerable to tripping. That means if you see any time there are swings coming close to this zone 3 boundaries, then you will identify them. You will look at their load encroachment settings carefully. You will alter their zone settings properly. Load encroachment settings you will review. Power swing blocking settings you will review. If required, you will enhance it with a newer generation relays, and therefore you can avoid it. So this is what the online vulnerability analysis of distance relay does, and this is the kind of screen that we provide to the system operator so that he can see which relays. The static database of the relay settings are already read from the system, then the actual swing is plotted from the PMU data, and the distance from the zone 3 is calculated. And if this distance comes below a threshold, then this is logged as a vulnerable relay. And you can have multiple views here, and then you can create you can create a log sheet like this here, so you can actually see which relays are getting repeatedly seeing events and so on and so forth. So I think it's 4:54 p.m. now, 4:55. So I'll take questions now, and then we can close this session here.
Participants are requested to ask their queries. Participants, if you have any doubts, you can ask the queries.
Hello.
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir, this is Jaideep Shah. Sir, there are a few papers related to GPS spoofing attack on PMUs.
Okay.
So actually, we are from electrical background, so we don't have much idea, but a few students, they always discuss cybersecurity issues on smart grid. So we should design a structure in such a way that it cannot be attacked by means of cyber issues.
True. So the thing is that today we have not focused on cyber security of the PMU infrastructure or wide area measurement infrastructure. But see, this is gradually going to become the backbone of electrical grids, you know. And if it is not cyber secure, then your systems can be compromised. So there are many types of cyber security attacks that literature has discussed. One of the most common that literature has discussed is false data injection attack, for example, on state estimator. You can see tons of papers there. GPS spoofing is a more technical attack, you know, but that is also so very much plausible. Denial of service attack is another type of attack by which, you know, the data is not just allowed to reach the control center. Then there could be, like, for example, you know, your Intel architecture and these architectures, they themselves have defects because of which somebody can go and play inside the registers itself. So there are those kind of attacks which are also possible. So strictly speaking, you know, at the physical layer level, then at the communication level, layer level, then at the PDC level and at the analytics level, you have to implement security. And just like probably you can never guarantee that there cannot be any blackout, probably it is difficult to give a guarantee that there cannot be a cyber attack. But a good utility would always be working on this. And at least as of now, I know that Ministry of Power is also looking into improving the cyber security of the electricity grids. That's something that it is very seriously looking into.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Participants, any questions? Is there anyone who want to?
Sir, one more question.
Yes, sir.
Nowadays, if Government of India plans that why we are dependent on GPS, we should go for IRNSS throughout the One Grid initiative. So if we make a firm policy, so we can use a Navic-based system, which is having a 2 nanosecond base error, I think. So that time stamping might be much better, but it is actually much more better because we don't need that much accuracy. It is good enough on GPS base also.
Yeah, so the thing is, see, 1 microsecond is reasonably good because, as I told you right now, that CT-CVT error seems to be now a more botheration. You know, the timing error seems to have come under control. But having our own GPS system, which could even be more better, is always better. Because you see, if you are using a GPS system which is from outside the country, American system or whatever, if you are using it, then there is always a problem that during wartime or any such kind of thing, sometimes they deliberately add errors into it, and that can impact the security of our grid. Now, we should not blow it out of proportion and stop technology march, you know. But if we have our own system in place, then it is always better to use that. So I think as the indigenous alternative